Once upon a time, the art of the movies was to suspend belief. Today, the art is to create belief. One of the greatest challenges in the modern cinema was to make you believe that a man could fly. They succeeded in a film called Superman.
One of the biggest challenges that Dick had, and all of the great special effects people that were on it, nobody'd flown on screen before, except in stupid ways where you could see the backdrop and they're going by. I mean, you know, the TV series of Superman. Nobody knew how to make him fly.
In those days, because there was no computers, it was hard effects. You had to practically had to do it in the camera. There was a few optical houses, but things were limited. And you had to convince the audience a man could fly.
He flew in about 10 different ways in the movie. There were wires, there was some animation. He was catapulted in some things. There was blue backing, there was black backing, there was gimbals that he was lying in. And a lot of it was like the Wright brothers.
This was experimental stuff we were doing back then. I remember at the time, just to get the shots, very technically very difficult to get them. The exposures, the balance between the plates and the foregrounds. Very difficult stuff, and so it was all a bit sort of string and chewing gum type, making it work.
We used many different techniques on Superman: practical effects, physical effects, optical effects, process projection, models, miniatures, anything to make a shot work we used. You see, this was long before computerization. That's made a big difference to us, because of course you can do things much quicker. But at this time, everything was hand-done, and it really was many artists and very talented artists that we had to use to do some of this work. Lots of effects had to be plotted and done manually, but it did give you a little opportunity to do a little bit more finesse than actually the computers do, in a sense, but of course it took a lot longer.
It was an absolute nightmare to make the man fly, and a fortune, absolute fortune, to get there.
You just can't give the special effects department, by that I mean all of the effects, too much credit for the most unbelievable job, because they were doing things that just had not been done on screen before.
Because we were quite desperate at the time, you know. We hadn't really figured out how to make it most effectively. Yeah, we could do it, but we really wanted to avoid this sort of visible tricks. We wanted to be smooth.
I came up with a system for making things fly, using two interlock zoom lenses. Christopher Reeve would be basically in one place on a pole arm that's pushed through the screen that you don't see, and he's there. And all he does is sort of make the moves, and it's the camera and the projector that make him look like he comes straight up. Besides that, you can rotate and, pan and tilt and do all that sort of stuff in addition.
Chris had immense patience, because, I mean, sticking the harness on a guy and hanging you by the parts that aren't too comfortable for many hours at a time, and him holding the pose and keeping his composure, and then still having to actually act and react to something at the end of it all. It's a technique. I mean, he had it down perfectly.
In order to understand how the lion's share of the flying shots are photographed, it's necessary to understand the principles of front projection. This technique was supervised by Dennis Coop. The key to the whole system lies in the 3M's beaded screen material, which we made our screens of. The screen can reflect light back in the same direction at almost 1,000 times the original intensity, but only in exactly the same direction it came. A piece of glass, mirrored on one side and transparent on the other, is placed directly at 45 degrees in front of a camera lens. A projector that's projecting a background scene, let's say typically the desert or metropolis, to go behind Superman, is then bounced off the mirror surface onto a 3M's beaded screen, where it is greatly intensified. The light is then returned directly through the transparent side of the mirror into the camera lens. Now we had the actors mounted on an arm in front of the screen, and we need only light them moderately to overpower the front projected image that will be falling on them, and they are seamlessly inserted into the shot. This is a lightweight front projection rig we constructed. The projector in this configuration is attached below the 45 degree mirror. This apparatus is built to be extremely mobile, to give as much movement as possible to the whole flying sequence. And Christopher himself can remain horizontal in front of the screen.
Nowadays, when you see a man fly, you want to see a man fly, you can fly. But in those days, you had to do it, and it was major, major thought process production. It narrowed down to a group of physical working people, not computers.
Zarin Perisic added an interesting twist to the process by synchronizing zoom lenses in the projector and the camera to allow Superman to appear to fly directly towards or away without ever moving.
The last act went not adagio, but super prestissimo, very quick. And I do recall that sort of rush to the finish line.
But the fact that Superman's costume was blue did present us with a particular problem. It was too close to the color of the blue screen. The wardrobe department had to create the costume closer to turquoise, which was different enough from the screen in color. Christopher then had to be lit so that we could return the costume to its proper color optically.